At the tomb, the shaking ground, the stone removed. This is Easter. The flash of lightning, the angel's testimony, the promise of Jesus, the empty grave. This is Easter. A day to hope against all odds, a day to worship our living God, a day to believe in the power of Jesus, a day to celebrate, and a day to remember. The curse is broken, the promise is true, the tomb is empty, the King is alive. This is Easter.
Good morning. Welcome to Calvary Temple Church. You are Calvary Temple Church, the people of God, and we are so glad to be able to worship the Lord together this morning right here.
Say happy Easter.
Over to you for the weather. Over to you for the weather. Happy Easter.
Happy Resurrection Sunday.
He is risen. There we go. Over to you for the weather.
Over to me for the weather. All right. In your pews, if you are here for the first time or the second time, yes, there are welcome little packets there, and there are some visitor cards. They're gray. We would love for you to fill those out, and then you're going to go during our meet and greet time. Go back there and see Mark Tudor. He has a gift for you. And yes, if you're here for the second time in a little while, fill it out again and go see him. He has another one too.
Sounds good. Sure, I can pray. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for today, for this time that we have to worship you. I pray, God, that we would know you, that you would show yourself to us. And Lord, we just want to celebrate who you are together. Thank you for your great love for us. Thank you for your resurrection power, that Jesus, you are alive, and you change us every morning. Thank you, Lord. Have your way in this time. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to ask you to stand, if you will. Daniel and the team are coming to lead us in worship.
Amen. We have a full worship team this morning. I'm thankful for that. But you're our full worship team as well. And starting out here, I'm going to get you all to be percussionists with me, too. It's Easter Sunday. I was thinking about all of the hymns that we typically sing at Easter and how hard they are for me to play and sing at the same time. I love this one, and I found a slightly different arrangement. I think you're going to recognize it. Don't think that we don't know what we're doing when we sing a little bit different from what you're used to in a couple of spots. Very thankful to have Kyle helping us out on guitar this morning. And so he's going to help me so that I can get us into a rhythm. All right, you're going to clap with me.
I serve a risen Savior, he's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy, I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, always near. He lives, he lives.
with someone you haven't seen in a long time. And while we do that, Pastor Chad's going to play the pipe organ for you. So enjoy. And also the adult choir. You guys can make your way up here. That would be great. last few months. She's been sneaking downstairs and working with our kids on a bell choir. So for all of our kids that are here, come on down. Come grab your bells. Come on down. Come see Pastor Andrew. Right over here. Right over here. Right on. Judas betrayed him for 30 silver pieces. That was a very nice one. This is right, what's this? It's a cup. Yes, thank you. That's a question. Do you remember what this is for? What? We do communion. You remember how we do communion? Yep, the Last Supper he had with who? His what? His friends, his 12 disciples. Do you know who else was there? Judas was there too. All right. Why do we have praying hands? Who prayed? Jesus prayed. He prayed in the garden before he was taken. You guys are so cute. He prayed in the garden. Again, look over here. Then, while he was in the garden, Judas brought people that arrested him. And they did, and they whipped him. We won't be doing that. What's next? What's this? It's a chicken. It's a rooster. Who denied Jesus 3 times? Remember his name? Yep, it was Peter. Mm-hmm. Let's put that in there. And then Bryson was talking about this today. They put Jesus on a cross. Something, it's probably a very rugged cross. And they put a crown on his head. But was it a gold crown? No, it was thorns. You're right, it was a crown of thorns that they put on his head. And they had a sign that said, King of the Jews. And this is the cross, represents the cross they put on. What does it look like, though? It doesn't just look like a cross, it looks like what? Like nails? It's an ugly sword. You're flipping upside down, it looks like a sword, of course. But it looked like nails. Yeah? All right. When Jesus died on the cross, they wrapped him in linen, and they put him in what? A stone cave thing. Yes, a tomb. And they rolled this big stone in front of him, right? And do you know why they did that? Do you know why they put this big stone in front of the tomb? So he couldn't escape, and they put guards there so that people would steal his body and say, see, he disappeared. So there was guards and this huge stone in front of the tomb. And what do you think is this one? Nothing. Well, that wouldn't be a very fun Easter egg, would it? But you're right. There is nothing. Why is there nothing? He woke up, yeah? He lives. He rose again. He wasn't there. The huge stone was rolled away and the soldiers were gone. And Jesus was alive! You guys did really well.
Let's give him a hand!
Yeah. Hey, guys, the hands. They are not excited.
They don't like coming to church at all. For the people that have been wondering, what is that noise? Is that the pipe organ leaking? What is that noise? We're just finishing filling the baptismal tank, so the water is running there. You may see the water rising up on the glass. Don't be scared. It's okay. We've decided this time we try to have it nice and warm rather than freezing cold like last time. So we had to run it a little bit today. So bear with us as we do that. At this time, we are going to, I don't even know what we're doing. We're doing this first. At this time, we're going to read a list of memorial donations. Easter donations and floral arrangements have been made in loving memory and living honor of individuals. And so there are flowers placed here at the front this morning, as well as financial donations that have come in. And these are the ones that have been sent in to us that we want to honor.
So in honor of Pearly Day by Susie Day, and she wrote, "For my father helping guide me to God." In loving memory of Christine Hall, daughter and mother, by parents Charles and Belva Hooper, and daughter Susan Hall.
Placed in loving memory of Oscar Mullen and Norma Mullen Griffin, parents, and Wallace and Barbara Hutchings, parents, by Mike and Melody Mullen.
In loving memory of Elaine Hurlburt, mother, by Chad and Laura Nickerson. In loving memory of Helen McCluskey, wife, mother, and grandmother, and Wendell Jones, friend, by Brad McCluskey and family.
Place in loving memory of Joe Marion Osborne, parents, Ken and Angus Osborne, brothers, by Pat and Cindy McGuire and family.
In loving memory of Verna O'Coin and Richard Pittman, by Pastor and Linda O'Coin.
In loving memory of Richard G. Watts, husband, father, and grandfather, by Faith Watts and family.
Placed in loving memory of David Wilson, father, by Stephen and Lisa Wilson and family, and Lois and Kenneth Donald, parents, by Lisa and Stephen Wilson, and daughter Lori McGovern and grandson Kenneth.
And in loving memory of Kathy Kingston, wife, and Michael Kingston, brother, and Danny Kingston, brother, by David Kingston.
Thank you so much.
Now I have some verbal announcements for everyone. If you are a visitor, feel free to text visitor to our number 506-634-1688. We are glad that you're here and we welcome you today. We have an online bulletin on our website, www.calvarytemplesj.com. This has all of our events that are going on for the month and weekly events as well, if you'd like to keep up with what we're doing. There's a team game tonight, this Thursday night, from 6 to 7:30 p.m. for grades 6 to 12. There will be group games, a devotional, and a snack. So invite your friends, tell your kids, grandkids, invite them. There is a seniors ministry next Saturday, April 13th, and it's happening in the Blue Room at 2 p.m. If you are of age, come for an afternoon of fun and fellowship. Just a reminder that we're having an Uptown scavenger hunt on May 25th. We are still looking for donations of individually wrapped candy, stickers, and chocolate, and the box is the purple box right there under the cross. Our pantry food item for this month is peanut butter. We need 100 bottles of peanut butter to bless our pantry ministry. Please place your donations on the table, the neon green sign, by Sunday, April 7th. And that's all that I have. Thank you.
I can never turn my own microphone on. I never remember. I've only been on staff 19 years. I still don't know when my mic is on. What can I say? Do want to just say it's so great to celebrate Easter with you today. We are so excited about this special day in our calendar and so happy to celebrate it with you. I want to mention very briefly before I move into our teaching time this morning that one of our longest serving members in our church has passed away. As many of you know, Margaret Wheelock went to be with her Lord and Savior this past week, and so there will be a memorial service. Tomorrow, there'll be a public visitation at Fundy Funeral Home in her honor at 12 o'clock. 2 o'clock will be a memorial service or celebration of life service at Fundy Funeral Home. And then immediately after that service, there will be a reception as well at Fundy Funeral Home as well. And we'd love for you, if you're free and able, to come and celebrate Margaret's life with us as we gather together. One of the founders of the Pantry Food Ministry, Calvary Temple Church. My wife was a summer student many moons ago, long before we became on staff, and she remembers the little Volkswagen Golf loaded to the gunnels with loaves of bread. It was enough room for Edgar, Margaret, and all the loaves of bread that they had donated, and they'd pull in the lot, and they'd say, okay, summer student, go unload them, and she'd have to get them out of the car so that the Wheelocks could actually get their way out of their car as well. So many fond memories, wonderful people. Join tomorrow if you can. It is my great privilege to be able to worship the Lord with you today and share the Word of God with you for the next few minutes before our water baptism. I want to share this quick little story with you as I begin. An atheist complained to a Christian friend, you Christians have all your special holidays, yeah, Christmas and Easter, and Jewish people celebrate their national holidays like Passover and Yom Kippur, but us atheists, we don't have any recognized national holidays. It's an unfair discrimination. And so his friend quickly replied, well, why don't you celebrate April 1st? Ouch! That was just nasty. Now, interestingly enough, this year, Easter Monday is actually April 1st. That's kind of interesting. Anyway, I want to ask you this question as we dive into our teaching this morning. What is Easter all about? What is Easter exactly all about? Some would say chocolate, some would say bunnies, some would say day off, whatever. But really, what is Easter all about? This morning I want to teach you from the Word of God for a few minutes and explore together. Guess who came to church today? Don't forget, we have teaching note pages. We'd rather if you not doze off. So we have some pages here or that entrance or at the main entrance as well. And you can follow along on the teaching note pages, or you'll find it on our website as well. Feel free to go there. You'll find a PDF document so you can follow through. This is Easter Sunday. Guess who came to church this morning? As you look around this room, you see many faces. You see maybe familiar faces. We've gathered today, this Lord's Day, this Sunday, to worship the Lord. You know, we see faces today of special family members that have come back home for Easter. Some of them have joined us today in this gathering. We have people here that have never been here this morning. We do give you a special welcome. We're so glad you came to come and meet with God together with us. But it's so important that we note the most special guest today. Who is here? This is Easter Sunday, and this is the very one special day out of the whole year in which we highlight in a very special, focused way the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Easter tells us that Jesus' death on the cross was not a disaster. It was not the end. Easter communicates to us that love is stronger than hate, and that God's heart and life is stronger than death. Today we recognize that Easter is really all about the reality of the living Christ who is with true believers in Jesus, active in their hearts all the time. God is with us in a special way when we come together for worship. Jesus made the promise to his disciples in the Gospel of Matthew in chapter 18 and verse 20. Jesus said there, as recorded by Matthew in his Gospel, where two or three are gathered together, my followers, in my name, I'm there with them. I'm there among them, he says. Now, as the years stretched into decades following the resurrection of Jesus, some people became disillusioned and even depressed. This happened particularly as they experienced fierce persecution against them and great suffering because of their loyalty to the Lordship of Jesus. The last book of the Bible, called Revelation, was given to John, the beloved apostle, while he was on exile on the Isle of Patmos. And he records, if you have your Bible or Bible app here today, feel free to turn to the book of Revelation, chapter 1. The book of Revelation, chapter 1, and verse 10. He records, it was the Lord's Day. I was worshiping in the Spirit, and suddenly I heard behind me a loud voice with a trumpet, like a trumpet blast. In verse 13, he goes on to say, and standing in the middle of the lampstands was someone like the Son of Man. He was wearing a long robe with a gold sash across his chest. Interesting to note, Son of Man was one of the favorite titles that Jesus used to describe himself, fully God, fully man. The word translated in the middle, standing there in the middle, is the exact same word found in the verse I just read a minute ago from Matthew 18:20, where it says, where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am among them. There I am in the middle of them. Friends, today we need to recognize and respond to this promise of the living Lord to meet us. To meet us when we come together in his name to pray, to worship, to proclaim him as King. He is there in the middle. Friends, today, have you experienced his presence today? Have you experienced his presence in this room as we've gathered to worship him? Yeah, I'm going to be honest, friends. I experienced his presence in the breakfast room when we had breakfast together. And we sat together and encouraged each other and talked about Easter and just had some fellowship time. I sensed him there as well. Friends, today, he is here. May we have ears to hear and eyes to see the spiritual reality of his living presence. I want to briefly share two facts of Easter with you today in this teaching time. Easter fact number one, our Lord is alive from the dead. Friends, today I want to encourage you that Jesus is not merely a historical figure to whose great deeds we can look back with great admiration. Jesus was not just a wonderful teacher and a nice guy. No, he is alive. And we call him Master, those who are Christ followers. He's actually living, and he has authority over death and the grave. We speak of him not as the one who was. Wasn't Margaret Wheelock a lovely lady? She was. But Jesus is, because he's alive. He's powerful. He's mighty. His residence on earth was only part of his existence. I kind of chuckle today when people say, oh, Jesus is a wonderful teacher. He's a wonderful man. Lovely, lovely guy. Wonderful father. No, no, friends, that was only part of his existence. Jesus' life did not begin in Bethlehem. Next Christmas, remind yourself of that. Jesus' existence did not begin in the manger. Nor did it conclude when he died on the cross that we honored and somberly celebrated 2 days ago. He truly is the living one. John the Revelator in the book of Revelation saw the Lord Jesus in the midst of the churches. In the presence of Jesus' Holy Spirit, he comes to abide with us and within us. Now I want to be clear for a moment, just for you theologians among us. Literally, the Bible is clear that Jesus is actually literally at the right hand of the Father. Matthew 22, Acts 2, Acts 7, Hebrews 10, Revelation 3. But yet Jesus is not limited by time or space. He's not removed from us in any way. So by his Spirit, through the Holy Spirit of God, he is indeed here. The triune God is active in the midst of us, near to us, accessible at every hour. He observes our every action, friends. Well, that's kind of frightening. He sees my every thought. In the fullest sense, he truly is that name of him that we celebrate, especially at Christmas time, Emmanuel, God with us. John the Revelator saw Jesus in the midst of the churches as the ruling Lord. In the scriptures, Jesus is described in terms that emphasize his sovereignty. He is sovereign. He is all-powerful. During Jesus' earthly ministry, he exercised authority over disease, over the demonic, over death, over natural events. Today we need to recognize the sovereignty of our Lord who manifested himself as love. And we should become the channels of that love, his love, to reach others. When I was a teenager, my younger cousin was enthralled with our church building when he visited it. He had never really been to church very much before, so when he came into the building and saw the building of the church that I grew up in, he said, oh, wow, that's wonderful. And what is this used for? Well, people come together and they worship the Lord and they celebrate who God is. Oh, weird. And he looked down the church office hallway at the church offices and very innocently pointed down to the office at the end of the hall that was the senior pastor's office, and he sincerely asked, is that where God lives? In that moment, the Lord strongly impressed upon my heart that we, the church, must be careful to represent the Lord of the church, Jesus, very well. People are watching our lives, friends. Well, I told you I had 2 Easter facts. We better get moving on. Easter fact number 2, our living Lord came to church today. Aren't you glad? By his Spirit, Jesus is here. He's moving and ministering and impressing upon us his care and his love and convincing us of sin and doing so many things. As we read the 7 letters to the church in Asia Minor written by John the Revelator in the book of Revelation in the Bible, we see after his vision of the Lord that there's some purposes of Jesus coming into the church and working in his church. Jesus accomplishes at least 6 things when he works by his Spirit in our worship gatherings and in our lives each day. Here they are. First off, Jesus came to church today to commend us. Christ wants to commend us as Christ followers in every area where we're seeking to serve for the Lord. My friend, today Jesus wants to affirm you. Jesus wants to encourage you. He says, I love you. He says, I've called you. He says, I've got a great purpose for you. Calvary Temple Church, Jesus sees you. He knows about your faithfulness, your endurance, your generosity, your kindness, your helpfulness. We can see this heart of God as revealed in Christ in John 21, where Jesus appears to his disciples after his resurrection while they're out fishing. The sign was hung, gone fishing, and they're out fishing. They've returned to do what they knew so well. And so then he calls from the shore and tells them, throw your nets on the other side. You'll get some fish. A great harvest of fish was caught. And then, isn't it bizarre? Easter Sunday morning, Jesus cooks them breakfast. John 21, read it yourself. Jesus, the risen Savior, cooks them breakfast. I wonder what kind of breakfast that was. I wonder what that would have been interesting, eh, Pat? Jesus showed up and cooked them breakfast. And he restored Peter after Peter had vehemently denied Jesus three times. The Lord Jesus ministered to him. He commended him. He encouraged him. He restored him. Secondly, Christ came to church even today to correct us. Friends, today Jesus in my life, he corrects me. He doesn't brashly condemn me, Chad, you stupid idiot. Why did you do that? You're such a failure. No, that's not the words of Christ. But he convinces me of sin. We find the truth of this in the Gospel of John chapter 3 in verse 17. It says, God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. To save the world. I'm so glad that I can be rescued by Jesus. I'm so glad that he can save me from sin, from myself, from addiction, from anger, from hate, from pain, from sorrow. Jesus didn't go to all the trouble to send his son merely to just point an accusing finger, telling the world how bad it was. No, he actually came to help. He came to put the world right again. He came to heal. He came to restore. All of us today, friends, need to let the Lord Jesus make adjustments in our attitudes, in our ambitions, in our actions. Jesus actually wants to help us every day as he corrects us. Charles Simeon was an English evangelical Anglican minister. But before Charles Simeon attended university in Cambridge, England, he loved horses and clothes, spending a huge sum of money on his attire yearly. Due to his college requiring him to attend regular communion services, he started to explore what he believed. After reading a few books written by believers in Jesus, he experienced a dramatic conversion on an Easter Sunday morning. Awakened early on April 4th, 1779, he cried out, Jesus Christ is risen today. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! As he grew in his faith in God, he devoted himself to Bible study, to prayer, to attending the chapel services at his university. Jesus radically altered the destiny, the priorities, and the life of Charles Simeon. And you know what, friends? He can do the same for you and me today. Thirdly, Christ came to church today through his Holy Spirit to cleanse us. In the Gospels, Jesus not only offered forgiveness, but he freely gave forgiveness to those who humbly came to him. Every time we come together in this place, in God's house, we need to come and do some soul searching, some heart searching, and put a sincere effort forward to confess to the Lord and turn from every sin. It's kind of like dust bunnies in my house. I take the vacuum and I suck out the corners and I vacuum it all up. I clean it all up and I'm like, yeah, she's clean. And 7.5 minutes later, they start crawling out from under my couch somehow. And I clean them all up and they crop up. That's what sin's like in our lives. It can creep up. It can crop up. And so regularly we need to say, Lord, sweep up my life. Lord, afresh in this moment. Oh, I shouldn't have said that yesterday. I shouldn't have did that yesterday. Lord, forgive me. Help me. I want your strength to walk forward, to live for you. That's why in 1 John 1:9, it's written to Christians. It's written to Christians. And it says, if we confess our sins to him, he's faithful and he's just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all wickedness, all unrighteousness. Jesus is more eager than we are to experience, for us to experience that cleansing joy that He alone can bring. Fourthly, Christ came to church today to convince us of wrong. Say what? Yeah, I want to mention this again. It's something that Jesus does. He convinces me of my selfishness, of my self-centeredness. And if I fail to be my best for Him and to allow Him to work in and through me, then He pauses me and reminds me of His perfect plan that He has. Chad, get your eyes on me. Chad, focus on me. Chad, live for me. He stops us in our tracks and convicts us of sin, letting us know that if we disobey God or mistreat others, we're outside of His perfect plan that He has. And you know what? Because I've opened my life to Jesus, He has the right to exercise authority over my life and to use me for the glory of God. I want to be His. Christ also came to church today to comfort us. Aren't you glad, friends? Jesus comes to soothe our deepest heartache. Even in all the wrong, even in our shame, even in our failed attempts, even in our wandering, or trying to fill the void in our life with everything else, Jesus still forgives. He still calls out for us to repent, turn from sin, turn to Him, and have a relationship with Him. That's what every one of us are craving for deep inside. You can try to fill it with the approval of others. You can try to fill it with something from a bottle. You can try to fill it from business, work, money, whatever. But it won't work because it's a God-sized vacuum that only He can fill. Some of us in this room today are discouraged. Some of us in this room today, you have the nice mask on. You look really pretty, but you're struggling deep inside with loneliness. Some of us today are experiencing the pain of grief. I want to encourage your friend, Jesus Christ will comfort you if you will listen to Him. Revelation chapter 2, verse 7. Revelation chapter 2, verse 29. Revelation 3, 22. All says the words of Christ. Anyone with ears must hear and listen to what the Spirit says. Understand what He's saying to the churches. My friends, today the caution is, will we stop and listen? Will we obey Jesus in our lives? Jesus came to church today to commission us. He came to commission us. Jesus didn't just save from sin, hell, death, and the grave. There, I got fire insurance. I'm not going to go to hell. Good stuff. Great. No, he's done more than that. He's commissioned us. He has a work for us to do, friends. If you're a follower of Jesus, if you open your life to God, there's a work for you to do. There's ministries for you to fulfill. In the Bible, in Matthew 28, in Mark 16, in Luke 24, in John 20, in Acts 1, God gave His followers a great suggestion, right? No. A great possibility? What is it? Yeah, it's the great... the great commission to tell everyone about Jesus. He's commissioned us. He's empowered us. He sends us out. In fact, if you try to stay in the nest, He'll give you a little book. Hey, it's nice that you're a baby Christian. It's nice that, you're time to get out there and share Jesus. Well, that's what my mom did to me.
Yeah.
A couple of ways, but anyway. We have an important job to do for the Lord, telling everyone about Him. Our needy world around us today needs to know about the love that took our Savior to the cross and the power that raised Him from the dead. The Apostle Paul, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, boldly proclaimed in Romans 8:11, "But if the same Spirit of God who raised Christ Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies by His Spirit who dwells in you." There's nothing like a radical life transformation power of God. The resurrection of Jesus is real. It's living. It's active. And it's powerful. Jesus said the words in John 11:25 that brings such hope. "I am the resurrection and the life," He said. "Anyone who believes in me will have life even after dying." Not only will we triumph forever with Him, but we also have that victorious, triumphant, supernatural authority in our lives every day. Blogger Kevin Lynn's life seemed to be utterly falling apart. In an article a year and a half ago, he recounted, "I actually put a gun to my head one day. It took God to supernaturally step into my room and into my life, and at that moment I really found what I now know is God. God intervened, and he prevented Lynn from taking his life. He filled him with the conviction and gave him an overwhelming reminder of his loving presence. Instead of hiding this powerful encounter, Lynn shared his experience with the world. He created a YouTube ministry where he shares his own transformation story as well as the stories of others. This is that revolutionary resurrection power of God that is at work in Jesus Christ. Just like the great old hymn of the church declares, we have heard the joyful sound. Jesus, Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around. Jesus, Jesus. Yes, he does, friends, as the worship team comes back. Yes, Christ came to church today. If you have not trusted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, he's here to come into your heart today to bring you the gifts of his forgiveness and new life. Today, if you've already trusted Christ as Savior, I want to encourage you, he is not only here to minister to us, but he's here that we might minister to others. The power-filled Holy Spirit of the living Christ, who has been with us here today, will also go with us when we leave this room. Friends, today I challenge you, recognize him, respond to him, let him be to you all that he gloriously is. May we have victorious life in you afresh today, Lord Jesus. Will you bow your head and close your eyes as we pray together today? Oh Jesus, there is none like you. Thank you, living victorious God, that you're real, that you're active, that you're willing, that we have relationship with you. Friends, if you're here today and you say, I'd like to open my life to God, will you just raise your hand? I want to pray specifically for you today. You say, I want to, nobody else is looking around, we have our eyes closed. You say, I want to open my life to God. I just want to quickly pray, very, very quickly from just right here. Just raise your hand. You say, yes, I need God. I need God in my life. I want to open my life to God. I want to follow Jesus. I need hope. I need peace. I need healing. Pray for me. Just raise your hand before the Lord. Thank you. Thank you. Jesus, I pray for my friends right now who have raised their hands. And Lord, we respond to you because we want to follow you. We want relationship with you. Lord, we simply say, yes, I admit I am a sinner. There is wrong, there is sin, there is shame, as there is with every human in my life. I can't deal with it. I can't make a relationship with you. But Jesus, I believe that you are the Savior, that you are God who came and took my place for all my sin, all my wrong, all my shame. You paid the price for that. You took that on yourself that I can be free through faith in you. So Lord, I confess that Jesus, you are Lord. I admit it, that Jesus, you are God, and I want to live for you. Walk with me now every moment from this second. I'm going to get myself a Bible. I'm going to read a Bible. I'm going to pray. I'm going to talk to other Christians. I'm going to grow in my faith in you, and I'm going to tell others about you, that I can serve for you and have a growing daily friendship with you, Jesus. You be the Lord of my life. Help me, God, to follow you. If you've prayed that prayer today, I encourage you to talk to someone before you leave this room about that. Talk to someone about it. If you prayed that prayer today and you want to follow God, there's little booklets at the front of this church down at the altar. Grab one of those. It's called What's Next. Grab one of those. There's also Bibles at the front. If you need a Bible that you can read in today's English, that's easy to understand, grab one of those Bibles and take that home with you that you can learn more about God. Now, the second group I want to quickly pray for today is this. If you're here today and you say, I am a Christian, but I want to serve for the Lord. I want to be more of a minister for Jesus. I want to let God use my talents. I want my world to know Jesus. Will you raise your hands? I want to pray for you today. You say, I want to serve for Jesus. I want to let people know Jesus more through my life. Thank you. God, help us. Help us to follow you. Help us to use our gifts for you. Help us to let you into our lives. I believe there are gifts resident that we don't even know exist. And I pray you'd raise those up and use those that many in this world would know your love, truth, hope, and power. God, help us. Go before us. Grow us. Challenge us. Stretch us. Risen Christ, be active and alive in our hearts. May we follow you more. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to continue to worship the Lord, and we're going to get ready. Those who are being baptized, you're going to leave now, myself included. We're going to get ready for the water baptismal. That'll happen in just a few minutes. And so let's just worship the Lord with music here while we get ready for that.
Chains are released, I can sing, I am.
baptized today would say today with every breath, I long to follow Jesus.
He's making me want to swear less, want to change it to him more. think before I talk and react the right way.
Sure. Thank you, Christina. So why did you want to be water baptized today?
I just wanted to become a gift of the Lord.
Does that sound good to you, church? Yeah. Sounds good to me. Let's pray together. Changing her and growing her and stretching her. We pray, God, that this would be the next step in her faith walk with you. Bless her and continue to overshadow her, we pray. Lord, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Pastor,
you baptize me in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
So we are planning to have another water baptismal service. We already have one or two people that are prayerfully considering following the Lord through waters of baptism. So stay tuned for that. That'll be in a few months. And we just want to keep celebrating as the Lord brings people to himself. I did want to also say, before I forget, because I don't have a great memory, we wanted to extend a very, very special welcome to our dear church member, Pauline Carson. We are so glad you're here. Healing journey, and we're just praying that God will completely raise you up, that you'll be cancer-free and healthy and strong for his glory. We love you, Pauline. God bless you, friends. Daniel and the team are going to close out our time today. Have a great day. God bless you.
I believe.